Coming up on Market to Market, as wheels turn, USDA delivers an acreage surprise. Producers wade their way through viruses, weather, and shrinking demand. We break down the numbers with Naomi Bloom, Ted Seifert, Angie Setzer, and Don Rose next.
Pioneer Hybrid International is a proud sponsor of Market to Market. Tomorrow. For over 100 years, we've worked to help our customers be ready for tomorrow. Trust in tomorrow. Information is available from a Grinnell Mutual agent today. This is the Friday, April 3 edition of Market to Market, the weekly journal of rural America.
Hello, I'm Paul Yeager. The biggest unknown in this monumental Black Swan event is the magnitude. Signals of the sheer size are still being revealed. Early returns show payrolls fell by 700,000 jobs, the unemployment rate shot to 4.4%, and the Mid-America Business Index tumbled below growth neutral. In the midst of all this, USDA released the prospective plantings and quarterly stocks report. For good or for bad, it's something farmers and traders wait for at the beginning of the season. We have assembled a panel of our regular market analysts to help make sense of it all. Joining us this week is Naomi Bloom. She is Senior Market Advisor for Total Farm Marketing. Ted Seifert is Chief Market Strategist for the Zahner Ag Hedge. Angie Setzer, Vice President of Grains for Citizens Elevator. And Don Rose, Founder and President of U.S. Commodities. Welcome, everyone. We'll hear from all of you in just a moment. But first, we need to give you the numbers for the week. May wheat lost 22 cents and the nearby corn contract dropped 15 cents. The May soybean contract tumbled 27 cents. May soybean meal lost $19.90 per ton. May cotton shed 35 cents per hundredweight. Over in the dairy parlor, April Class 3 milk futures plummeted $1.20. A devastating week in the livestock sector with multiple limit down days in the trade. June cattle cut 8.58, May feeders slashed 12.83, and the June lean hog contract shed 15.92. That's a fall of nearly 25%. In the currency markets, the U.S. dollar index increased 204 ticks. May crude jumped 31% or $6.63 per barrel on prospects of talks with OPEC and Russia. COMEX gold dropped $5.90 per ounce, and the Goldman Sachs commodity index gained 6 points to finish at 275. All right, you four. I know you drew the short end of the straw to have this discussion. We got to get to it, though. Let's start with your tweet on if you had to for this week's report. Naomi, I'm going to start with you. The government report, it seems so long ago, but give me 140 characters on that report.
I would say that the report was initially perceived as bearish for corn as far as the bigger acres and a little bit supportive for soybeans and not a lot of big changes for wheat. But I think the report pretty quickly was dismissed by most of trade in terms of acres, just because the data collected was a few weeks old and a lot has changed in the meantime. So I think we probably saw the highest corn number for the spring, and we'll see what the rest of the spring brings on for us.
All right, Ted Seifert, your best tweet in this report.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to agree with a lot of what Naomi just said. I'd also like to say that 180.5 combined row crop acres would be the highest number we've seen since 2012, or actually higher than 2012. I don't see that happening. And as Naomi said, I think there's been a fairly large shift of about 1.5 to 2.5 million acres out of soybeans into corn just in the last few weeks. So I think more realistically, in my mind, corn acres could be around 95 million, bean acres around 85 million. As far as quarterly grain stocks was concerned, it was a bit of a bullish number for corn, but now we're getting into a period where we'll see a big drop off in ethanol. So the concern is what happens this quarter.
All right, hold your thoughts on ethanol. We know we have that coming. Angie Setzer, I think I saw you tweet earlier this week when we talked about percentages on that increase of soybeans, a little misleading in the headline there, but still, what's your tweet?
Yeah, really, I mean, everyone's kind of touched on what I was thinking. Obviously, we are a long way away from having everything into the ground. I think a lot of economics, a lot of other factors have come into play that will make some additional changes. agree with Naomi that the high side of corn, I think we've seen, you know, and the reality is it's easy to say that we're up significantly versus last year, but I think we really need to go back and compare to 2018, what those intentions look like. But we're also starting the year with moisture similar to what we saw in the 19 when it comes to soil profiles. So that'll have a big impact, I think, over the next couple weeks, next couple few weeks as we move ahead.
All right, Don, you don't have to agree with everybody, but what's your take?
Well, I think when you look at it, there was something for everybody in this report. It was bullish on the corn stocks. Realistically, what it really meant is probably last year's yield was understated. So you look forward to this yield with the weather. The acre number was larger than we thought, but probably muted a little bit, some acre switches back. The soybeans, just the opposite. We had a bearish stocks in all positions report, again, probably told us that the acres are probably, or the yield is probably understated last year. Well, the acres number a bit positive, but I think, you know, the bottom line is all those numbers, still overall too much grain in the U.S. and the world. And so you come out of the report, you go in negative, you come out negative, and you look at the outside markets.
Outside markets. So, Naomi, I was going to ask you a question about are the technicals or the fundamentals, either of those in control right now when it comes to trading any commodity?
I think it's a combination of the technicals are in control. We are seeing some very strong downtrending markets for corn and soybeans. Fundamentals right now are on the sidelines just because of the fact that the coronavirus is just front and center stage. And fund selling, that's the biggest component right now coming into the market. We've got that money coming out of stocks. It's a new quarter starting April 1st. And so when the funds come into the market, they can be buyers, they can be sellers. Right now, they're sellers.
And one of the things, Ted, is this ethanol thing. You talked about it. I mean, oil, yes, it rallied a little bit here in the last couple of days just on some talks. But ethanol is really a major pull right now in this corn market. Is what's going to change that?
Yeah, first of all, to the question that you asked, Naomi, technicals, fundamentals, this is a headline-driven market, and it's driven by sentiment. It's driven by what's going on in the world and what's going on with lockdowns and whether we're going to get back to work and start using ethanol, start driving again or not. And what we saw change midweek, we went home at the end of last week thinking, okay, we're going to shut it down for 30 days and then we're going to come back and it's going to be business as usual. And we figured, all right, 30 days isn't going to be that big of a problem. But then somewhere around midweek, when we started seeing things happening again in China, which made us worry that there's a second wave there, made us really question that what we're doing here in this country, that 30 days is going to be enough. Maybe this is going to go on for a lot longer than that. So that's when the ethanol really came under pressure. You've got plants that are shuttering or really slowing down their production. Bids are dropping. Corn has a domestic demand problem because of the ethanol industry. The longer this goes, the more those ethanol stocks just build and build and build, and it's going to take longer to dig our way out of that. So that's the concern. That's where the pressure came in later on in the week for corn. And really, it's just, when are we going to get back to it? When are we going to be driving to Des Moines, for example, to do a show called Market to Market? And until stuff like that starts happening again, it's a big uphill battle for ethanol.
Well, and Ted, you travel a lot. You get in an airplane and go. You're not even able to do that right now either.
No, that's right. I mean, I can't even drive to work, but none of us are. None of us are driving to work. We're not taking public transportation. We're not flying in airplanes. It's just we're grounded. You know, we're in our houses. We're not doing much of anything. That's a problem for energies as a whole. The thing that could help us would be exports. We look over at China and say, hey, China, which they did buy last 2 weeks, they've had some nice purchases of corn. Come and buy some ethanol. That would be fantastic. That could help put a Band-Aid on things for a little while. But we need something. And until that happens, we're in trouble.
Angie, is there any something on the horizon for corn?
No. I mean, when it comes down to it, for corn, the one silver lining that I thought we had at the end of last week was going to be feed demand. And now this week, we're running into some pretty significant issues. We're seeing milk being dumped. I'm hearing my egg producers or have nowhere to go with the eggs that they're producing. My hog producers aren't refilling the barns after the hogs are going to slaughter because the pork price is so poor. And so I'm not trying to pile on with the ethanol story, but the reality is, you know, Governor Cuomo said that this thing could last into August. So that doesn't help when it comes to the driving demand and all of the other factors at play. And really right now we are trying to hang our hat on exports, which have been phenomenal. you know, I think for the last couple of weeks, and we have this really great window of opportunity now because we're not competing with South America, and you know, your Black Sea region exports are going to be a little bit slower. We're the cheapest corn in the world, but that we really have to keep an eye on. I guess the silver lining for corn right now would be whether or not the dryness continues in parts of Brazil, and if we continue to see a problem there when it comes to their second crop corn production capabilities. But at this point, we're really kind of struggling when it comes to feed and ethanol, all of which going back to, we're stuck in our home offices. We're not going anywhere. We're not going out to restaurants, and we're not driving. So
all right.
It's a struggle.
It is a struggle. Don, you want to add in on this?
Yeah, you know, when you look at it, we are the cheapest corn in the world now. And just a few weeks ago, we were expensive. And so we're basically the cheapest, and we should build some demand where our exports, we thought were going to be down maybe 100 million, probably just down 50 million now. And I just want to remind everybody that 39% of the demand is ethanol corn use, 39% feed, and about a 10 to 11% on the export front. So, but energy to end the week, Paul, was a positive. We had a good close, and we are biofuel, so it's not all negative at these low prices.
That would be the one bright light that we have. Naomi, if I would have had you on last week, I would have said, the top is in wheat, and you would have said, yes, Paul, it is, and you would have sold, but do we think the top is in now?
For the short term, I do think so. Wheat futures were able to hit some overhead resistance on daily charts last week. And we didn't have any follow-through momentum from the USDA report this past week as far as friendly news. So the theme overall, just for the moment, continues to be global surplus of wheat. So there are thoughts that maybe Russia or Kazakhstan might reduce some of their export capabilities as they are trying to maybe hold on to some of the wheat product that they have. And there was talk even that Egypt might be doing some additional buying of wheat. But the market just didn't get that additional burst of friendly news this week. So the path of least resistance is just a setback or a correction lower. If you look at some monthly charts, the Kansas wheat futures actually have some nice longer term bottoming action. But that doesn't mean it has to go straight up from here. That's something that could take, you know, 2 or 3 months down the road. So short term high is in, yes.
All right. So, Angie, I want to ask you about soybeans here. Meal was the winner last week and kind of lifting that. Then meal ended up not being real friendly. What's moving this complex now?
Well, I think it goes back, the meal conversation, I think, goes back to kind of what I was talking about earlier when we were piggybacking off from what was taking place with ethanol. I think everyone's kind of seeing this, sort of panic develop in the livestock sector. And that's making you wonder if you are going to see folks kind of double down and continue to produce in looking at the future of problems potentially with processing and things of that nature. So, just kind of jokingly said earlier, we've got to have animals to feed. Obviously, we have animals to feed. Like, you can't just shut them off. You're not going to get rid of them. You know, at this point in time, I have a lot of friends that I speak to that feed cattle that, you know, I picked up a load Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. I'm going to continue to feed these cattle. I'm going to continue to feed hogs and birds and things of that nature. We just basically have a bit of a pinch in the pipeline that we have to work through. But that causes all of these other reverberations throughout the industry. And I think that's really what has influenced meal quite a bit. And, you know, from an overall standpoint, we're still looking at significant crush margins. Crush margins are still pretty good. So I think as a whole, it doesn't have to necessarily negatively influence soybeans long-term, but I think the short-term panic of everything that is taking place just kind of took meal and everything else right along with it this week. I think there was just really this idea that you just had to sell everything because that's all we knew what
right
to do.
All right, so Don, I want to ask you when it comes to beans, Angie talks about the crush. Are we going to miss our window in South America? They're having coronavirus and port issues. Is that window going to shut here in a hurry to take the place of what South America has been providing to other countries?
Well, you know, really what's happening, you know, back up to the meal, Argentina, they're down about 10 to 13% on their exports on soybean meal, their largest meal seller in the world, just because of some of these logistics issues. The same thing happened with the wheat on Friday with Russia on some issues with the coronavirus on shipping. But I think when you look at the soybeans, South America has had some issues at the end with their crop. The Brazil crop's probably smaller. The Argentine crop smaller. And I think the issue is we probably don't have an export window until we hit past August. And that means our exports are probably 50 to maybe 150 million too high, Paul. So that's okay. A bit of an issue. Drug on the front end months this week.
Don't worry, Ted, I haven't forgotten about you. I need to ask Naomi one question, then we're going to start. Naomi, we saw those horrible video and still images of people dumping dairy. Normally we've seen that in Europe. We're seeing that in the United States. This is an extremely, we thought we had tough times before. We have it tough now. What's going on?
Supply chain issue. That's what's going on. So the biggest component is that, of course, we've had bountiful milk production for the last couple of years, and demand has been steady. But now you have a situation where you have the consumer who normally had been school children drinking their milk out of the little cardboard cartons. And then you had people just drinking from, at restaurants and things like that. So now what has happened is that the demand has switched over to the retail sector, and we can't get enough like plastic jugs or quickness to shift over production to where the demand is now at the retail sector. So the product is there. It's just that some of those processing facilities, they're normally set up to process milk a certain way, and that's not where the demand is. So unfortunately, some of those places like DFA are saying, you guys got to dump your milk for a few more days, which is gut-wrenching to people in the industry, especially then when you see milk prices go from $18 down to $12. It's just not helping by any means. Right. So again, it's a supply chain issue. There's workers not showing up at some of those plants for processing. And we're low on truck drivers also because people are staying home who are in the industry and they're not working. And so again, it's a supply chain issue. So hopefully in a few weeks, we'll get through it. But again, it depends on how long America is staying at home and where right. that demand lies for the bigger picture.
All right, Angie, Ted, when it comes to the meats, which one of the three that we normally talk about on this program, the feeders, the fat cattle, or the hogs, which one gives you the biggest indigestion?
Indigestion.
Not physically meat. Like you're going to have a sandwich or a hot dog.
Yeah. Listen, I think the cattle traders need to take a cold shower because, it's just panic and pandemonium, limit down all the time. You can say the same thing about hogs. You know, looking at December hogs below 50, looking at cattle across the board below 88 for the most part, it's wild. You know, cash is still trading higher. The concern is that the big rush that we saw in grocery stores, everybody stocked up their freezers, that we're not going to go back and buy more beef and we're going to have product just rot. With restaurants being shut down, we're not going to do carry out. It's a shell of what it was. Yeah. So maybe demand has taken a bit of hit, but I don't know about you guys. I'm eating more. I'm calling it the COVID 15 instead of the freshman 15. There is demand. We're still eating. I think we're getting very undervalued now in all of the livestock. There should be some support here at some point. We just can't seem to find that bottom right now because fear and concern, panic is really what's running these markets at the moment.
Don, I know you wanted to discuss some of the meat. Which one gives you biggest concern? Is it different than what Ted said?
Well, I wanted to point out we kind of have a cross on the meat market between the BSE year, if you remember, in 2003 on cattle. That's when we had a demand fear, from the disease. We went from 96 to 71. Tonight, June cattle closed at about 80. And in the other year with the hogs, with the capacity issue in 1998, we went down to 21.50 on the futures market. Tonight, April hogs are closer to $30 live. And so we kind of have a cross there. But I think it's really all uncertainty about the demand and how long does the virus continue is the real issue. But, these markets certainly are across something in those two zones.
All right, Angie.
Well, I think it's important to point out, too, with the livestock sector, that it's not just the uncertainty over demand. That's what's caused the indigestion. You know, where it's really coming into is what happens with our processing capabilities if we do have a plant or two or three have to shut down. And I think that's what's causing, in my opinion, the bulk of the fear in the future side of things. We know that demand could probably be impacted. Reality is most urban dwellers don't have an extra freezer or two in their garage. So they are going to kind of be continually trying to get to the store in order to bring some beef or chicken or pork home. But I think the real concern is what happens to the meat on the hoof if it's not able to be processed. Kind of the similar situation is what we're seeing in the dairy side of things, where if you do have that pinch point when it comes to your production, what does it look like then? And for the most part, you know, feedlots have been relatively current. We've been seeing some pretty decent pull ahead since January. You know, pork exports were 45% better than last year too. So it's not as though we don't have the demand necessarily, but we are concerned about what it looks like if we create this significant bottleneck here over the next 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 weeks.
Naomi, I think you're wanting to chime in. I can tell.
Yeah, what I've been hearing is that some of the packer plants are suggesting that they're not going to have enough workers to work because people are needing to stay home. One client from Iowa said that he was told from his packer that some of these places aren't going to be offering bids to even buy cattle for a couple weeks. And so if that's the case, you know, they'll buy as needed, but the market, the futures market, catches wind of that. And that's what pushes the technical selling lower.
Yeah.
So Angie has brought up awesome points as far as, you know, the demand is there. It's just the short-term hiccup of our supply issue.
John?
Well, I just wanted to point out, you know, we're talking about the negativeness, but we got a lot dialed in. The June cattle futures are about a basis, about $20 under what they normally are. So same thing with the hogs. So you're out of line on the futures market to the downside. It's just a matter, can the cash really catch that bid to the downside?
Ted, there was a report this week that there were French pigs being flown into China to help restock. But yet that market, you know, Angie mentioned the percentage, how far we've, you know, increased. But that's a little like the soybean story. It's a little misleading from last year because we were dealing with ASF. Is China even an option for us in terms of taking our finished product? Or is that not an option right now when it comes to the hogs?
Sold China 19,000 metric tons of pork last week. So they are buying. They're just not buying the 170,000 per week that we were hoping for. I think what's going on in China is they wanted to move their hog facilities up to the north and east into these hog hotels, these huge concrete bunkers that are vertically integrated. This ASF problem that they've had, coincidentally or not, served them a couple purposes. It helped them in their trade war with the United States, with us. It also helped them do exactly what they wanted to do. I think that China's a lot further along rebuilding that herd than what they're letting on and what we really want to believe. So I want to be optimistic that China's going to come in and buy a ton of pork from us, but that was a sign that, hey, they're rebuilding their herd, and they have been for a while. I don't think the losses are nearly as great. The losses were there, but when we look at it right now, if we were able to look behind the curtain, I think we'd be shocked by how robust their herd is at this point.
Well, we always have to deal with the underreporting of things out of China, and that was a story this week out of the president. I do have one question here as we wrap up. Shane in Bloomfield, Minnesota, and we do thank all of you that have sent us questions for this panel via Twitter or Facebook or Instagram. We do love hearing. I want to bring you Shane's question here. What are some things that would put spec funds into the commodities? What are the things algorithms look at to trade? Money flow, fundamentals, or just the word of the USDA? All right, which one of you four want to tackle that one? Don Rose has volunteered to fall on that one.
Well, I just want to remind everybody from a long-term trading standpoint, remember this, that all of the news that is bearish now is the same news that'll be bullish. So, you know, weather's good, it turns bad. No ethanol demand, energy firms up. So all these things turn around. So remember that when you're thinking about the negativeness of the market.
All right. So Angie, go ahead, Naomi. Sorry.
Just going to add real quick that the funds are in the market. The speculators are here. They're following the technicals. They're following the algorithms of computer selling. They do follow the seasonals and they follow those USDA reports. Just remember last year, corn for the funds, they got 300,000 contracts short by the beginning part of May. We think they're probably about maybe 160,000 short. I didn't get a chance to see the CFTC report today, but they're in it. And again, they're in it to make money. They can make money as sellers, but you know darn well, just like Don was saying, that when the first hint of friendly news comes, they're going to turn around and start buying this market, and then we'll have a rally, hopefully in time for summer and some better prices for all the farmers.
All right, Angie, 30 seconds.
Yeah, I just think right now headlines are going to continue to dominate, and so is just the general overall feel of the market. Eventually, what, you know, like Don said, what is bearish turns bullish, but I think we'll be seeing some news stories that we have to be paying attention to, weather especially, We have no risk premium in any market, in my opinion, at this point. And so I think we have to start discussing what that needs to look like.
Ted, it's always good to see you. I wish I could give you more than 10 seconds, but you get five.
And if the dollar continues to drop and the crude oil goes higher, commodities will go up too. Watch those two markets.
That's Ted Seifert. Thank you so very much. Angie Setzer, good to have you back on the program. Don Rose and Naomi Bloom. You four, thank you so very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
That wraps up the broadcast portion of Market to Market, but there is still a lot more to talk about. We'll cover it in Market Plus, where we'll answer more of your questions. You can find it on the web at markettomarket.org. And if you are searching for more to put in the school classes you're conducting from home, then check out Market to Market Classroom. You'll find plenty in the sections on science, technology, and the business of agriculture. Go to markettomarket.org for more. Join us again next week when we'll explore how experts are pushing an old grid system in a new direction. So until then, thanks for watching. Have a great week.
Market to Market is a production of Iowa PBS, which is solely responsible for its content. Pioneer Hybrid International is a proud sponsor of Market to Market. Tomorrow. For over 100 years, we've worked to help our customers be ready for tomorrow. Trust in tomorrow. Information is available from a Grinnell Mutual agent today.